Good afternoon. I want to welcome you to Speak Freely. This is the 2023 edition of the African Diaspora International Film Festival. We have one of the founders and we have two filmmakers. Doctor, could you introduce yourself, and then the filmmakers, would you be kind enough to introduce yourself, tell us a little about you?
Well, I am Dr. Reinaldo Barroso Spech, one of the organizers of this event. We started the R&I, the Film Festival in New York City in 1993. And for the past 16 years, I think, we have worked with several organizations in DC. And we also have the festival there. I don't like to call myself festival director. I would like to be called a culture activist, because this is what we would like to do. We would like to promote this, the human experience of people of color from all over the world in films.
Uh-huh. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Maria.
Hi, thank you for having me. My name is Maria Judice. I'm a filmmaker located in San Francisco, and my film is called Elephant, and it's going to be premiering next week.
Congratulations. Yuhi?
Awesome. Thank you so much. My name is Yuhi Amuli. I am a film director, producer, and screenwriter from Rwanda. My film is Citizen Kwame, and I'm honored that it's going to be screened in DC this week. Thank you.
Great, great. Doc, I was wondering, has it become easier or more difficult for you to pull this type of gathering together?
Well, it's a combination of both.
Yes,
technology has helped filmmakers tremendously. And that has helped the work of curators. Curators, as we are exposed to more and more content out there. It is more difficult because the content that was at a certain time available for film festivals and other activities is now quickly moving to other platforms. And sometimes it's a little bit complicated to have a film that is already available on Netflix or any other platform and play it in a festival, because there's not much of interest to come and see it and watch the film and all that. I mean, that brings us to the possibility of making our events a different experience, let me put it that way. Mm-hmm. I don't want to use any adjective, a different experience. And also, we have experience. I mean, I remember this year, I met Yuhi in Berlinale, in Berlin, in Germany. Mm-hmm. And I remember the time, we have been going to that festival in Berlin for quite some time. And I remember the time when it was very rare to bump into African filmmakers in any kind of activity in that kind of big event in Europe. Mm-hmm. Well, that has changed. Major film festivals in Europe are playing African cinema and all the kind of Afrocentric theme content.
Yes.
So that has made easier for us to come across work of quality, professional work, because one of the things that the R&I and other folks who have worked with us have paid attention to is the quality and the professionalism of the content we expose people to. It is not because we are a small event that we want to show things that are not with the standards we expect to. So the fact that African cinema and Afrocentric films, for example, a film that you're going to see from Brazil, Executive Order, it was in different film festivals, the Rio Film Festival, places like that, when you are exposed to that material that some years ago was completely unknown, you are exposed to comments, discussion with colleagues, write-ups by different critics who attend the events and all that. And that professionalizes in a certain manner the work we do, because as you know, Afrocentric cinema is marginal, even though what I'm saying can give the impression that it's not. Afrocentric cinema is marginal. I was reading this morning an article about the Oscars, and when it comes to international cinema, the Oscars took some time before accepting that category. And in that category, the international component of the Oscars were mostly Eurocentric.
Yeah.
So you see the evolution of things.
Yeah. Maria, can you encapsulate for us what it's been like for you to pull your work, your film together? How easy, how hard, what were the challenges, and I'm sure the feeling of exhilaration that it's out there, your baby's out there now for people to see.
Yeah, that's a good question. And it's also just like an overwhelming question. So for me, I worked on this film for probably 5 years. I worked on it as I was making, as I was producing another film, and as I was working a full-time job. You know, and that's why the film A took so long. And then there's those whole, you know, two pandemic years in there where I was like doing my thing. And then, you know, we had to shut down. So I kind of just was like, I guess the film's done. Let's go into the editing. But it, as an indie filmmaker, I think, you know, especially being in the US and particularly being in San Francisco, a really expensive city to live in, it's not easy to turn around projects or to put projects up. And so it takes us a long time to figure out, especially if we're trying to be, you know, adjacent to Hollywood in the industry and not have all of our feet in there and have some autonomy by being independent filmmakers. You're just navigating like what you can do, when you can do it, and how you can do it, and where's your money going to come from. Yeah. And then once the film is released, you're kind of like pushing and all these other avenues, right? Right when you think the film is done, great, it's out there, you're like, oh, now we gotta go into this like marketing phase. Now we gotta promote. Now we gotta figure out, you know, where's the movie gonna get seen? You know, and also all that is also gonna cost me money. So I gotta figure out like how I'm gonna still keep my full-time job while I show up to the festivals, how I can bring the actors and the crew so they can celebrate on stage with me and also have this like community conversation, which is a key component to the film. We've been able to do that at about, I think you guys are like our 15th film festival right now.
Oh, okay.
We've taken the community with us to as many as possible. And, you know, I just want to say like this, that is the key component of why film festivals should exist, is because I was able to introduce people who had never been to a film festival before, people who had never been to avant-garde and experimental film festivals before, people who had never been out of like Alabama or Oakland before. And they came to the film festival, and some of them were very white and some of them were very Black. And their eyes just opened up. You know, they had a whole new world, not just of film festivals, but the storytelling of all the movies they got to see while they were there, all the people, the international. And as hard as it was for me, I would never do it differently, you know? And I always say like, you know, people, I run into friends and stuff at film festival, be like, how you doing? I'm like, girl, I got the whole family with me. Pray for me. Because, you know, they're people you made your film with and you love them to death. But also you want to usher them into this world and you want to protect them from all the elitism and all that at the film festival. But also you want to like push them in and be like, don't worry about it. We're here. We're being super Black. And every single time it's like the best experience, best conversation. So much of the feeling of the reason why I make films. And a lot of my career has been, you know, this kind of elitism, very white experience at a film festival. And if I can disrupt that in any way, I really want to, but I also really prioritize films that are regional, film festivals that are regional, and film festivals that are, you know, really focused on, you know, minority cultures and people and experiences, because that's where you get most of the love. Those big film festivals, they're really lovely. They're great. But, you know, they got Brad Pitt over there. They ain't worried about you.
Yeah, right.
Those really give you love. So I hope I answer your question.
You did. Yuhi,
Yes, sir.
Where did you film primarily? What location?
Where did I film?
Yes.
The location was in Rwanda, in Kigali. And it's funny that you ask that because the film is set entirely in one compound.
Okay.
So it was in my house, the house where I lived in Rwanda.
Uh-huh.
That's where I filmed.
Is there any connection between Citizen Kwame and Citizen Kane?
Not a direct one, but Citizen Kane is a film I admire a lot. So that title is kind of an ode to that film.
Okay. What is it that prompted you to make this film?
Personal experiences. My experience looking for visas to travel essentially anywhere outside of my country and the frustration that comes with that. And then COVID kind of accentuated that feeling. So that's where the idea came from. That's what pushed me to write the film and to decide to make it.
I'm wondering how big, how big is Rwanda's film industry? Is it growing? Is it minuscule? Is it voluminous?
It is small. I would say we are, first of all, the country itself is small. The economy is very small. Some people would even argue that we do not have a film industry.
Mm-hmm.
But, and I think there's some truth to that, but the reality is we are a group of a few people who know each other, who are making films and actually making good names for themselves,
mm-hmm.
like ourselves. For example, when I met Dr. Reinaldo in Berlin in February, we were actually representing a film made by a Rwandese female filmmaker that was selected at the film festival, which was really awesome. So the film industry is not an industry, I guess, in the purest sense of the word, but a group of filmmakers who are there and actually making impactful films.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I guess a proof of that is the fact that there's a film from Rwanda that's showing in DC. Like that's
that is awesome.
Barrington, let me say this.
Yes,
Juhi, I understand well, but I would like to say that the film industry in Africa is 54 countries. Mm-hmm. So you find the production of films at different stages.
Yes.
All over. Right. All over. Mm-hmm. Different stages. One place where you can have a larger understanding of what's going on in the production of films in Africa is FESPACO. FESPACO is the biggest film festival in Africa. It takes place every 2 years, and many filmmakers from Africa go and show their films,
mm-hmm.
Because they have different sections. And there you see, how vibrant the production of films is on the continent.
Yes.
The role we play here, I'm talking about our film festival, the Pan-African Film Festival in LA, mm-hmm. where we met Juhi in LA, as a matter of fact, the first time we met, and other film festivals in the United States, particularly what is known as Black Film Festivals. Not all they don't use the terminology African, but they use Black, and we are all Black.
Mm-hmm.
And many of those film festivals incorporate films from the continent.
Yeah.
And this is one of the roles that we play here in the US, where there is a movement to know more about Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So we play films from Africa, the different degrees, the different stages in the African film industry development that we see in the continent.
Mm-hmm.
And when we can, because all of us have we have financial problems, we are able to invite filmmakers and discuss about the film industry in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
We, at this time, I'm talking about now us. I'm talking about the festival. As you know, the festival is part of a structure that our Matin Productions is structured. In that structure, there is a film distribution component.
Mm-hmm.
And we have been able to release African films in theaters in this country.
Yes.
This is not an easy job to do here. Mm-hmm. Of course, we are not in the commercial circuit. We are in what is known as our house circuit, which is a smaller operation. But in those theaters, they had a tradition of playing international cinema. So we don't go in there claiming that we are African, blah, blah, blah. No, we are an international production of interest to your audience, who in some cases is a travel audience, is an audience. We tend to go into universities. I mean, the festival we have takes place in a university where supposedly we have a fertile soil there. So, I mean, this is what we have been able to do, and we are going to celebrate in New York City 31 years of work. We have been able to put African cinema in theaters. Let's not talk about streaming. So let's not talk about DVDs, even though people want DVD. No, we're still selling DVDs and things like that. Mm-hmm. So African cinema, when we began in 1993, I remember in New York City, they had not seen an African film for quite some time. Mm-hmm. And let's not talk about a film coming from Martinique, Guadeloupe, even Cuba. So we were able to do that, and we have seen the evolution, and generally in the continent, and it's promising. To be honest, it's very promising, and I wish sometimes that we here in the United States, where we have a different structure, we have maybe more opportunities, we could collaborate even better, so the exchange could be richer. But we're still pushing.
Yes. Well, I thank you for the work that you've been doing. The impact continues to ripple. And and I really, as a Pan-Africanist, I too hope that we can overcome our prejudices and the national boundaries and come together as Black people, global Africans. So that is my hope. And that is a part of why Mimi and I do what we do, because we understand that we have a platform and we love the idea of bringing varied, diverse minds and people, Africans, together to discuss issues of concerns to us. At this moment, I want to play the trailer for Elephant, and then we'll talk to Maria so she can give us more insight into the story and the storyline. Okay, one sec.
Nice. Aww, congratulations.
Wonderful. Tell us more.
So it's a story like Yuhi, where I shot in one spot for over a number of years.
Oh, awesome.
This story is about a woman who witnesses the murder of a young boy on her doorstep. And this is before our 2020 uprising. This is around Ferguson time, where me personally, I was involved in a lot of like activism within San Francisco and finding myself just really burnt out and you know, finding myself super reclusive. So in the story, this woman, you know, just really suffers a mental breakdown and, you know, decides to really take time for herself, but she really can't leave her apartment for over a year. And so it's her community that helps her move through her pain and, you know, her trauma, and witnesses her experience with her to help her finally, after a year, move out of her space. And she's surrounded by, you know, loved ones, community, family, lots of plants, and kind of navigating and understanding, you know, what healing means for her and what also living within the oppressive state of the United States and what that means for her, not just herself, but generationally. So she has lots of conversations with the people around her to, you know, understand what this means and what's different, what's the same, and what's the future, all those things.
Yeah, it's interesting because as I talked to you and as I watched your trailer, it just seemed, I saw so many connections, particularly with the George Floyd uprisings, and particularly with the fact that COVID has brought mental health and self-care and those issues to the forefront in ways that that we didn't expect. It's, as a journalist, I've written quite a good deal about the impact of COVID, and one of the things that that is so apparent is that the infrastructures that we thought were robust, in place, and able to take care of us are mere skeletons. Because they were saying, I did a story where they said that the healthcare infrastructure had been hollowed out by greedy administrators who did not reinvest in the most important parts of the structure and were just more concerned with executive pay and those types of frivolous things without thinking and caring about reinvesting to ensure that when we had a crisis like a COVID, that, that the healthcare system would be able to take care of those of us most in need. So, yeah. So.
Yeah, not just those of us most in need, also, you know, I'm in San Francisco in particularly, and, you know, we have a pretty severe problem with people who are unhoused, not just that we have a housing shortage, but we also have an increase of the number of people who have been, you know, forced into homelessness because of the pandemic, because of unemployment, because of a lack of housing, because of lack of mental and physical access to healthcare. And so, you know, I always think, like, you know, being here, I saw so much before the pandemic of people right on the edge.
Yeah.
What the pandemic did was like, literally was like, that Band-Aid just fell right off.
Yeah.
And so our homeless situation particularly increased 3 times the amount. And today it's just increasing. And now we're dealing with the intersections of homelessness, mental health, drug addiction, increase in not just COVID, but other, you know, public health viruses that are hitting the community because they're living in these very dense populations. So just living today is so overwhelming. You're overwhelmed and you're like, well, how do I fix these things? And how do or what part do I play in it? What part is this, you know, a part of my community? How do I support it? And, you know, sometimes the best thing you can do, which I hope this movie does really give people like these pathways to understanding, like sometimes the best thing you can do is take care of yourself before you help other people, or just take a time out. And I think as this movie illustrates, like the story of a Black woman, you know, this, you know, caregiver for for America, this mother for like the nation, is really telling her to like take your radical act and take a time out, like sit down and rest. And if that's the most radical thing you do this year, girl, that's your activism. And that's what you should be doing. And when I talk to, you know, other people in my community, whether they're women or men, whether they're activists or they're just going, you know, to their gig job every day, the last thing they do is rest.
Yeah.
And so then everything just exacerbates, and you see us like in these, especially the Black community, especially, you know, I'm from Generation X hip hop community, like people are dying at the age of 60.
Yeah.
Like 60? That's crazy. Yeah. Like, my grandfather, you know, lived to 98 and he lived through World War II. And, you know, we can't even, our generation can't even make it past the age of 60. Yeah. So we need to ask ourselves, like, how much A is this country wearing us out? Mm-hmm. And causing us to be sick and take not the best care of ourselves? Mm-hmm. And how much responsibility do we need to take for making sure that we live long, beautiful, healthy, joyful lives? You know, and I'm not saying it's easy, but if you can kind of just like take a time out and say, I'm gonna just sit here and stare at this wall until something comes to me, I think that's okay.
Yeah, yeah. We're gonna take a look at Yuhi's trailer. One sec. It's so interesting because a large part of what we're dealing with now is the marginalization of African people. I saw a piece the other day, a story that I read, and there was a foreign minister from one of the African countries asking, why do we have visas to travel to African countries? Why do we have visas to travel to Europe and the US and Canada when they can pretty much travel anywhere visa free? So this is a real issue. Yep. Tell me more. What prompted you to, again, I may have asked, but I'm sorry if I did. What prompted you to tell this story?
Well, I had asked for visas before, but the last nail in the coffin was an experience I had where I experienced the longest visa process of my life, which included learning a European language as a requirement.
Whoa, okay.
The process of I did learn the language. I sat for the exam. I passed the exam. I applied. I got the visa. But like this whole process just clicked something that I didn't know I had in me. And as I said before, the frustration culminated into me writing this piece. And as you just mentioned, it also came from that indignation of wondering why the ones that are coming in have it easier than us who are trying to get out. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. that's the thing that inspired the film.
Yes, yes. Doc.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. As we round this out, do you have any final thoughts? I'll ask each of you to about your final thoughts about the film, the DC Festival. Can you tell us when it is? Tell us the date and stuff.
We are going to start on August 11, and we will be running films until the 13th of the month. Okay. We are working at George Washington University. There is a center there. I think it's the Student Center. Mm-hmm. It's George Washington University Student Center, which is located on 821st Street Northwest. Uh-huh. We have, I don't know how many films, I didn't count the last counting.
Yeah.
We are very happy. This is something that I have to put forward. Very happy to be back. Last year was our first film in person at the film festival in person. After the pandemic, this is going to be our return in person. Uh-huh. We have a selection that is very representative of the feelings in this festival, a film like The Woodstock of House, that was the opening night film here in New York City last year. And it is going to be the opening night film. You know that we have a festival in Paris, France.
Yes.
And it's going to play there in Paris too, the opening night. We have a rare film that I think people did not remember much, and we decided to bring it back because the young lady, the director, we know her, and we gave her an award. Last year she was in Paris. I mean, she won the award in New York City, but we gave it to her in Paris. Is She Had a Dream, which is a very rare film, a race film coming from a North African country. We have been talking about many things regarding North African countries.
Yeah.
And Raja Amari is her name. She made a film about this Afro-Tunisian, this Black Tunisian, and how she is engaged in helping the transformation in her country. She engaged into politics because she wants to do something for the human condition of women over there, and the situation with Black Tunisians. This is a very rare film, and we are bringing it back. There is a classic, I think it's a classic, about Zora Neale Hurston, an incredible film that got lost, I think, because I don't know, things like that happen. And we decided to bring it back because she is an incredible personality. We have a small retrospective, very small. It's not even a retrospective. It's a spotlight on South African cinema.
Okay.
We wanted to go. South Africa is one of the most important film producers in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And the films we have, just three films, we have something bigger in New York City this year. The three films show different moments in the history of South Africa. And the last one, Blunt Eye, talks about that many of us have dealt with corruption in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
But this time is from the perspective of someone who is trying to ameliorate conditions, not someone who is trying to be critical just for the fun of it.
Yeah, yeah.
We have a film like that. We have a very, that film touched me. It's a film about music, jazz. I love jazz. Mm-hmm. And it is a film that begins with a woman who is known as the soul queen of New Orleans. Music picture New Orleans is the title of the film, and then it goes through different moments in the musical production of New Orleans, and we end up watching how Marsali's father her siblings, her children and all that. It's an incredible film. Music picture New Orleans is the title of the film.
Okay.
Again, we are going to be here over there for just 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
So we begin early. We have shows at, like in the big film festivals in Europe, 10 a.m. and things like that. Mm-hmm. But I hope people would see and understand that this is due to the fact that we have so much that we see all year long.
Yeah.
And we know that in 3 days, we cannot give you everything we want guys to expose you to.
Yeah,
and there's another element that is more more commercial. That theater costs a lot of money to be there.
Yeah.
You see, so because this is another element that we mentioned when we were with the small film festivals.
Yes,
so many things are not for free for us.
Because
we are not necessary. Maria mentioned that in some film festival they have Brad Pitt or maybe Denzel Washington. So.
Yeah,
well, we come along with our little film. It's like, oh gosh. So we are a little film festival, but I think we have a lot of heart.
Yes.
And the fact that we are celebrating 16 years in DC means that we have people who follow what we do.
Uh-huh.
So we start early and we have filmmakers around. We have receptions. I think Maria is going to be with us.
Yeah.
Talk about her work and her experiences.
Awesome.
And you will be with us in New York City. We are not.
That's right.
Yeah.
So that's right.
More or less. I didn't mention. We have a film by an incredible filmmaker from the Caribbean, Guadeloupe to be exact. Mm-hmm. Christian Lara. Christian Lara is a friend. We know Christian for quite some time.
Yeah.
And he has a number of films. Mm-hmm. This one, Yaffa, is an important film. It's a conversation between an African from the continent and an African, what I call the historic African diaspora in Paris. It's mm-hmm. not in Africa, it's in Paris. Yeah. Africa is the decor. And mm-hmm. then we see things. The African is an immigrant, but he happens to be a history professor. Mm-hmm. And the guy from the Caribbean is a guy who's a cop, but he's not that well trained. So yeah. the conversation is very rich. And we have some religious element that walk in there, represented by a woman who is the liaison. So, I mean, it is very, very, very important film to watch. Yeah. And as I mentioned earlier, Executive Order. This is a film from Brazil, directed by one of the most important Black actors in Brazil that went behind the camera to make this film. Basically, the story is that why Brazilians decided that they were fed up with Black people over there and they are sending back home. So,
okay.
we have some of that
yeah.
and more. So please, I mean, if there are any questions, we are at 212-864-1760. And again, we are at George Washington University, the University Student Center.
Okay, thank you, Doc. Yuhi, any last thoughts?
I would like to just say how immensely grateful I am for this opportunity to get to show my film at the African Diaspora International Film Festival. I'm very honored.
Good.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to talk to me. We appreciate it. Maria.
Thank you.
I just want to give a final shout out to Rwanda. Because the film that I was producing was Neptune Frost, which was in Rwanda.
Wow.
I was in Kigali for like 3 months producing that film. And we probably know a few of the same people, Yuhi. So, you know, email me later and we can talk.
You should have answered the question about the Rwandan film industry.
And I completely defer to you, right? Like we came over, we shot with about, I think, 250 Rwandans, a few Kenyans, a few people from the Congo, but it was the best time of my life and some of the most amazing artists ever. So I like to say it's emerging. It's an emerging industry. It is there. And if you just get rid of some of those white people that's dominating it, y'all be good. Y'all be fine.
Yeah. I hear you. Yeah.
So I just want to give a shout out and I hope to see your film. And you know,
okay.
I
hope to see yours.
Yeah, and you know, feel free to email me or whatever. And thank you so much, Reinaldo. Thank you, Barrington. I really appreciate this and I'm excited to come to DC and I have family in DC. So we gonna turn up just a little bit, don't worry, only a little bit Black, but I got them all to come and show up and I'm excited to see you next week.
Okay.
So we're gonna, Mimi and I are gonna be coming through. So we'll be looking out for you.
Awesome. And
amazing.
Great to see you too, Mimi.
Thank you.
Good to see you too.
I'd like to come in at the end and just bring up the rear, but as I was listening to the show, it sounds fantastic. I look forward to seeing your films completely and to enjoying this festival. It is a staple in our household and amongst my people in the area. So it gives me great joy to have you guys back in DC in person.
Thank you.
Awesome.
So we normally end Speak Freely with a little known filmmaker / artist, my son. and it's kind of hems up what our show is about. But thank you all for coming on to Speak Freely with Barrington Salmon. We appreciate it. And you should be able to see this on YouTube, on Facebook, on LinkedIn, as well as the African Diaspora International Film Festival website.
So spread the word.
Awesome.
We'll do.
Thank you all so much.
We will share the link.
Thank you so much.
And
yes, please.
Thank you, Barrington. Thank you, Mimi.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
So we're going to play Bald Fist to take us out.
Thank you.
Yeah. living like a black man. Yeah, imagine living like a black man. Yo, a black man in America. Sorta kinda like being treated just like a terrorist. Living how I'm living, it's really no comparisons. They systematically trying to kill us, now that's the scariest. I swear the numbers getting various. I'm feeling like I'm Harriet, an underground soldier for my people that I'm carrying. They killed George Floyd, now I'm trying to fill the void. This the life my brother's living, it's really hard to avoid. I keep my hoodie on for Trayvon, I do it for my day ones. Sandra Bland spoke about the path that we should stay on. I can't breathe through this nonsense. The killings coming constant. The crooked politicians is never willing to stop this. Yeah, Breonna Taylor, say her name, say it again. Breonna Taylor, say her name until we win. I pray to God daily, deliver me from my sin. Trying to start a revolution, and here is where we begin. Yeah, if you want some change, you gotta model it.
What else?
Yeah, speak about your feelings, never bottle it.
Let's talk about
it. Try to do it peaceful, shout to Kaepernick. I really hate the fact that black lives not mattering. It's time to shift the narrative, I'm switching up the pattern.
Yeah,
it's a pandemic and racial wars that I'm battling. Saddened by the hate and discrimination, it's real. They gave us freedom under control, knowledge, man, what's the deal? Man, who's created equal? I'm trying to find the equation. Founded on oppression, we live in this situation. New days coming, I know that my people waiting. Swear we praying for a change and my brothers is losing patience. Yeah, so I gotta live for Oscar Grant. And I gotta live for Eric Garner. And I gotta live for Terrence Crutcher. Swear I gotta live for Michael Brown. Yeah, man, I gotta live for Freddie Gray. And I gotta live for Betty Jones. Swear I gotta live for Nipsey Hussle. Swear to God that I'ma grind and put my people on.